Hello and welcome to this October 17th scheduled meeting of the Board of Education. As a point of order, I would ask you now to take a look at your cell phones and turn them off. If you could completely power them down, they interfere with our RF feed, and then we'll have no problems at getting on. And if you would join me now in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Man, that was great.
Thank you, folks.
Just full of energy. Okay, first order of business, we'll roll call. Mr. McFarland, could you do the roll call?
Sure. President Brandstatt is absent. Vice President Singer.
Here.
I am here. Treasurer Wasserman.
Here.
Member Baker. Member Frazee.
Here.
Member Gordon.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Very good. Thank you. Moving to our consent agenda, we have items 2.1 to 2.5. We have approval of the meeting minutes from September 19th. 2.2 is the staff members announcing their resignation. We have four resignations. Item 2.3, we have persons recommended for employment. We have two of such persons. Item 2.4, we have approval of the payment of the school system's bills for the months of August and July, as listed in the check register, for a total amount of $12,240,469. And item 2.5, we have legal invoices for payments in the amount of $138 and some cents. I'd ask at this time if anyone had any additions, deletions, or comments.
None.
Seeing none, I would accept a motion to.
I move approval of 2.1 through 2.5 of the consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes carry it. Now I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Sherrill for a few very special awards.
And hopefully I can do this without coughing too much, a little bit under the weather. So our first Shining Star employee is Miss Millard. If she would come forward, please.
Turn around.
That's awesome. Look at that.
Turn around, look.
Okay. Oh,
right. Mr. Ovation.
This one's
she missed her standing ovation.
Yeah. Maybe we can do it again.
And this one, as you'll hear, is a little bit different, and partly why they're probably so excited. Teresa started in the district with EnviroClean in 2014 as a second shift fill-in cleaner for all district buildings. In 2015, she was assigned to a long-term second shift temporary cleaning assignment at Carpenter. In August of 2015, Ms. Millard was placed on the first shift temporary building manager position at Carpenter, where she continues to do an outstanding job. Our office received many Shining Star nominations for Teresa, more than we have ever received for someone.
Oh.
Among their comments, her nominators wrote, Teresa has been a one-woman pitcher of action, caring for the building conditions and overseeing the cleaning and reconfiguration of Carpenter. With six new staff and multiple classrooms repurposed, she has been a friendly and extremely helpful presence in acquainting new staff to their classrooms. We are blessed to have her in the building, and it would not be in the terrific shape it is in without her guidance, work ethic, and can-do attitude. She embodies the going above and beyond mantra of our best employees. I was a new hire this year, and Teresa went above and beyond to help me get acquainted with the school and prepare my room for kindergartners. She makes it a point to drop in, and she is always the first person there in the morning preparing the building for the school day. She takes pride in her work, has the expectation for her night team to also have pride in their work. She is patient with with our students, even when their choices cause her more work. We all enjoy Teresa being part of our team. Ms. Millard has done an exceptional job as our head custodial coverage. She works hard to meet the needs of all the groups who use our facilities. She takes initiative and looks for things before they become an issue. She is dedicated to our schools, staff, and students, and certainly a shining star. The staff at Carpenter truly appreciates everything she does and would like her to know how much we care about her. She is exceptional. I am so grateful for Teresa, and I'm excited for her to be recognized as a shining star. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, and congratulations on your fan club.
Okay, stop, turn around, and look at your ovation. There you go. Congratulations, thank you.
Congratulations, thank you.
And our second shining star is Amy Burks, if Amy would come forward.
Oh, look, look, look.
Amy earned her Bachelor of Science degree from the Miami University of Ohio in 1992 and her Master of Arts degree from VSU in May of 2014. She worked as a Title I teacher, extended day kindergarten teacher, and guest teacher with MPS from 2005 through 2008, and then eventually began her MPS career in 2008 as a 0.5 kindergarten teacher at Chestnut Hill Elementary. In 2010, Amy moved to Seabird Elementary as a 1.0 kindergarten teacher and two kindergarten classes in the AM PM section. In 2012, MPS transitioned to all-day kindergarten model. Ms. Burks was part of the district kindergarten team for the all-day transition. She continues in her teaching career, giving Seabird Bulldogs an amazing kindergarten experience on the first leg of the academic journey. Amy was nominated for the Shining Star by an MPS colleague. Among her comments, a staff member wrote, "Amy shows amazing willingness, dedication, skill, and kindergarten kindness when working with our youngest students and when faced with a variety of students' strengths and challenges. The calmness, intuition, and expertise she knows on a daily basis is truly incredible and unmatched. Her classroom is very engaging, and her students make amazing progress academically and socially." Congratulations, Amy.
Amy, thank you. Everybody's standing for you.
Congratulations. Thank you.
And we have two presentations tonight. And the first up will be Carpenter School. As you can see, they're well attended tonight. And Mr. Lauer will start them off.
Good evening. Thanks for the opportunity to be here. I can tell you that I'm very proud to be a leader of leaders at Carpenter Street School, not only in the teaching staff, but in our student population as well. We've got a bunch of great teachers and a bunch of great kids, and many of them are represented here tonight. They're part of what's called our project-based learning camp, which has happened this past summer was the third summer that this has happened. It's that driving question and providing a problem for students to solve, and then the students working collaboratively to make that happen. It's the basis of STEM education. It allows our teachers to train on actual students, and students benefit from the learning that occurs during that time. So let me turn it over to our leader on this, and that is Chelsea Sove, who spearheaded this for us this summer, and then she'll introduce you to the kids.
We're happy to be here tonight. As I said, my name is Chelsea Sove. I'm a kindergarten teacher at Carpenter. So it's really exciting for me to get to work with an older group of kids each year and see familiar faces of students that I've had in the past and some of the other teachers have also had. There were seven teachers that were involved this summer. Some of them are here tonight. And we have Rebecca Stern is here, Annie Harrison, Amy Slaybaugh, Amanda Lamont is here, Laura Willannon, Katie Kret, and then we also had Kaylee Pluff, who is on maternity leave right now, so she couldn't be here with us tonight. So this is our third year, and we were actually able to extend it from a two-week program in the past to now a four-week program, which turned out to be really beneficial for the students. And as Mr. Lauer had said, project-based learning, it's a little like PYP in that it starts with the driving question. It has all those same ideas with inquiry-based, except for PYP has the central idea, which is really based on your unit, and project-based is we bring them with a problem or a question that they can solve. This year, our driving question was, how can we promote expected behaviors and teach others how to be everyday heroes at Carpenter Street School? From the driving question, the entire project is student-led, student-driven, and it is also aligned with our Michigan standards, so we make sure that those are well-defined throughout. We provide workshops and things as the needs progress throughout the projects. In addition, to increase the students' buy-in, Mr. Lauer, we got to go to a really neat conference in Indianapolis before to put this all together, and we called Mr. Lauer and asked if he would make a video for the students. And our theme for our school is superheroes, and so we thought, what a cool tie-in with everyday heroes and superheroes. And he kind of did like a whole calling all superheroes video, and he was really neat with it. I wish we had it here to show you. We didn't have enough time. Really, he called for their help and talked about how behavior is something that we see a lot of, and we need more support, not just from the adults, but from our everyday heroes and kids throughout the school. So from that, as the project progressed, we were able to have a lot of members of our community come and talk to the students, and they shared their life stories and how they got where they were at, and also shared the expected behaviors that they need to have in order to be successful in their positions. Just to name a few, we had Officer Mahavir come in, Firefighter Greg from the Midland Fire Department came, and Aaron Walker from Community Mental Health. We also took them outside of the classroom quite a bit. We were very fortunate to be able to take them to the Barstow Airport. We took them to Northwood University, where they actually got to meet with students. They were amazed when they got to go sit and eat in the cafeteria and see what that was like. But they also got to hear where these students came from and what they needed to do to be successful. So that was a really, really neat experience. In addition, they went to the Loon Stadium and got to meet the players there and get their perspectives on life and how they're expected to be as athletes. And then we also took them to a big culminating field trip to the Michigan Science Center in Detroit, which is all STEM-based. And so they got to do a lot of things with, they met some scientists there, they watched a couple presentations, and then did some things with engineering that was pretty cool. So the students worked very hard for these 4 weeks, but they also are bringing that into our school year currently. So I'm happy that some of them were able to come and share their projects tonight. The first student that we have that's going to share is Gillian Smith. So if you want to come on up.
Hi, I'm Gillian. This summer we figured out that there were problems all around the school. So we're figuring out how to change that in the whole school. We did some research by interviewing staff. One solution we came up with is a ticket box. How it will work is that we will give a few tickets to each staff member, including teachers. If they see a student doing something good, they will give them a ticket. They will write the student's name, the learner profile, and the teacher's name they received it from. When they get permission, they may go drop it off in the office. The tickets will be put into a drawing at the end of every week. Mr. Lauer will draw 12 through 15 names a week and announce the winners at the end of every week.
Hi, I am Neva. We made the ticket box and wrote a letter to the PTO to ask for money for rewards for the ticket drawing, like school supplies and candy. Another idea we created was placemats for the Upper L students. The Upper L placemats have reminders of expected behaviors downstairs, such as voice level 2, eat your own food, and be respectful. Alexei will talk about the Lower L placemats.
Hi, I'm Alexei. I'm going to be talking about the kindergarten placemats. The kindergartners downstairs in the lunchroom need helpful reminders of the expected behaviors during lunch times since they are new to the building. We put reminders and pictures of expected behavior on the placemats.
also made a video representing the expected and unexpected behavior happening around the school. We created the video to show others how to follow the expected behaviors at school. Another part we created is an essential agreement to help all of our pieces fit together and be successful. We will post the essential agreement. The teachers and students will sign a page. Our next action is to present the essential agreement at an assembly to our school.
Hi, my name is Kendall. I am a part of the Outside Recess Group. We created the FBI group, which stands for Friendly Behavior Investigators. We are outside to provide support for students who may need helpful friendly reminders. Our purpose is to help maintain safety and to be positive role models. To remind students of expected behavior, we took action by creating an essential agreement for the playgrounds, along with a video of expected behaviors. Our essential agreement will be hung by the door that leads to recess. Each teacher will go over those and have each student sign the essential agreement.
Hi, I'm Lalo, and we're part of the bathroom group. We chose this because the bathrooms are getting shut down a lot. People are misbehaving, destroying property, and being disrespectful. We interviewed Ms. Whale to get the idea for the bathroom checkout procedures, and we decided to make a bathroom sign out sheet.
Hi, my name is Maria. We made a bathroom checkout sheet for the first through fifth grade classrooms. Students will need to check out and sign back in with their name and time.
Hi, my name is Lillian Black. The purpose of the check-in checkout sheet is to help teachers know who is using the bathroom. This encourages students to have good behavior.
I am Lily. We ordered digital clocks to help tell the time I'm when signing out for the bathroom. We chose digital clocks because they are easier to read for students. To get money for the clocks, I called my mom because she is the PTO president, and then she spoke with Ms. Stern, who is the PTO treasurer. We had to type a proposal letter to the PTO asking for digital clocks.
Hello, we are Booker and Banner from PBL Summer Camp. We worked on library expectations after interviewing Ms. Port and figuring out there were unexpected behaviors during library time. Our idea was to create library monitors.
We've decided to have a sign-up sheet with the teacher making the final decision. The student library monitor will be a member from the classroom attending the library. Our first step is to broadcast and announcement to generate interest. Then we will have a training once a month to check in. And train new monitors.
Hi, my name is Rylan. Over the summer, our group worked to help people to be safe on the stairs and in the gym. We emailed Mr. Welter and found out students were not following directions and were playing unsafely in the gym. For the stair expectations, we created a video to show expected behavior to keep people safe. Ms. Jacks was our contact, who identified the problem on the stairs. When I first called her, I messed up because I was nervous. I reflected, and the second time, I did better because I had written down what I wanted to say. We extended our learning by creating our script outside of PBL camp. Recently, I applied our expectations by giving friendly reminders to students on the stairs to slow down and be safe.
Thank you.
Through taking action to help promote positive behaviors in our school, we have learned to respect others and ourselves. Our trips inspired us to take action. We also learned to work together by creating an action plan throughout the school.
Expected behaviors are not limited to our school community. They're expected to the communities we live in. We learn to compromise. We learn different ways to find information and affect ways to communicate those ideas to our school community. And thank you for having us. Do you guys have any questions?
Thank you. We most certainly do have questions, I'm sure. I would like to open it up to the board.
Is this one grade level, or what grades are these students and what ages? Yes.
It's incoming third and fourth graders.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Did you have the right answer?
Yes.
Okay.
Can I see the posters a little up close and personal here?
Yeah, I'd like to see the ones with the pictures for the kindergartners.
Like, you guys worked hard on the posters. I want to be able to see them here.
They wanted to show the videos, but we didn't have enough time. They Thank really you. Worked hard on those.
Thank you.
Just theirs.
Only theirs. Yeah. Want to bring them on up, guys?
Go ahead. Take them up.
Nice.
Very nice. You guys make those yourself? Yeah. Yeah, that's. You guys did a good job.
Okay. Placement.
Very nice, guys.
These are the upper L placements.
Thank you.
Oh, placements. What a great idea.
Also, you should
awesome. That one's upside down.
Very nice.
Cool. Thank you.
Oh,
those
yeah.
are great.
Oh, all right.
These are.
I like the ticket.
Very nice.
Well, that's the ticket. Have you gotten any?
Did you bring any?
Oh, you just started. I think this is going that way.
Do we have any more questions for the group?
Chelsea, I do have a question for you. Have these ideas been implemented actually in the school and are being used daily?
Mm-hmm. We have just started the PYP tickets. We've met about three times since school started and got all this stuff together and made it neat, fixed some of the, made some corrections on some of the pieces, but we actually have an assembly scheduled within like a week and a half. So they're gonna present a lot of these out there. I do know that, Kendall's group with the badges have started out in the playground. And then a lot of them have just kind of taken the lead without having all of the stuff up yet. But it's a matter of getting the essential agreements out to every classroom, which is kind of where we're working at right now.
Okay.
So,
Kendall, have you seen any changes out in the playground, being an FBI agent? Okay. Okay. I just want to say I think you are all brilliant. These are all great ideas, and they're very relevant, and they're very insightful. So thank you so much for coming tonight.
And I want to compliment you for your speaking skills.
Yes.
It is incredible how articulate you guys were. You are wonderful. Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much.
We want to wish Kendall a happy birthday today because today is her birthday.
Oh,
happy birthday, Kendall.
Happy birthday, Kendall.
How old is she?
Eight.
Happy eighth birthday, Kendall.
Wow.
And throughout PBL, when Firefighter Greg came, he taught us something that we won't forget, and it is rock on you.
Aww.
Rock on you!
Nice job, guys.
Thank you.
Okay, our second presentation tonight is the Northeast Girls STEM Club, and we'll turn it over to Mr. DeBoyer and see if he can top that presentation, Mr. DeBoyer.
Great job, Carpenter.
Sure the mic's on.
Is our microphone on?
They left it on? Is it on now? No, you, everybody on TV. No, missed my joke. It's probably good. Probably good. I'm sure Ted Davis is watching right now. We're proud of many things at Northeast, one of which are the numerous clubs that we have. We have over 32 student clubs. Some of them have been longstanding, started by staff, and just been traditionally renewed. Some have started this year by students. And last year, about midway through the year, Jen Lennon, our outstanding learning coach, came to me with an idea to start a STEM girls club. Everything that Jen has done at our building has been outstanding, and I thank you for that resource that we have. And so when someone like that has an idea, the best thing to do is say, what do you need from me, and go right for it. And so I'm going to turn it over to her, her husband Tom, and six of our wonderful young ladies from Northeast to explain what they do.
Thank you for having us here. We're very excited. As you can see, we've got some girls in the first couple of rows over there with their t-shirts that they designed for our club, and they'll be up in a few minutes to field your questions. But I'm going to start off with my husband, and we're going to explain a little bit about what the club is about and why we decided to start this club and what we've done up until this point, just since March, because we really began in March, and then where we see this club going into the future. So here's a few images from our STEM club here, established 2016, and you know, the why part of it. Women make up about 50% of the workforce, but only about 25% of the STEM workforce. Also, women that are in STEM careers make, on average, 33% more than women in other non-STEM careers. Another thing that was quite interesting to me is that, you know, from 1970 to 1990, STEM occupations, the amount of women in STEM occupations increased quite a bit, but then from 1990 to 2011, it's really leveled off and plateaued. And that was concerning to me, especially in the age we're living in right now. So we decided that we wanted to expose more girls to STEM experiences and STEM careers. So we came up with this idea, my husband and I, as a partnership between the Chippewa Nature Center. My husband is the director of land and facilities there, and then Midland Public Schools. And we were able to secure a grant from the Michigan STEM Partnership. Now, I don't know if you've heard of that before, but we do get grants for robotics through this program. But we also, as this grant was started from the Nature Center toward Midland Public Schools, but really from the Nature Center, we were able to get even more money, grant money, to work on some STEM projects. So that's a little bit about how we started this last year. And so I'd like to let my husband kind of talk about that partnership just for a couple of minutes, and then I'll take over again with the rest of the slides.
Hello, thanks. My role here, like Jen said, is Director of Land and Facilities. And so, of course, I'm interested in the research end of things out at the Nature Center. And I don't know if everyone knows, but the Nature Center has its 50th anniversary this year. And I know over those 50 years, Midland Public Schools has been a huge part of the Chippewa Nature Center. And you look back at the old photos, and it's the Midland Public School kids that were coming out on field trips. And so it's neat to see that still happening 50 years later. And it's exciting to be a part of it as a staff member today. And so thanks for that. And I'd like to thank the girls and all the teachers, the Nature Center staff, and even a lot of the volunteers that came out and were chaperones for the day, because it was a big day. I'm going to let the kids actually talk about what they did. But I want to thank them. And someday, hopefully, we'll have some of you out there as volunteers doing other projects and maybe being employees of the Chippewa Nature Center. That would be excellent. But just to give a little background on the Nature Center and why we chose what we did is over the 50 years, we had a deer population that has grown to very high populations, and especially in the early 90s, we had populations of 110 deer per square mile. And they were eating every wildflower that we had out there, every native tree, like your maple tree, or, and if you know the Nature Center, we do our maple syrup programs. And so if the maple trees aren't there, we start getting concerned, and I know a lot of the community starts getting concerned. And so we started this deer harvest, and we used to do helicopter surveys on a biannual basis, just to monitor how many deer we had on the property and were we gaining ground and how were things going. Of course, that's extremely expensive. It's only one point in time every other year. And so always trying to think, well, how can we monitor these deer in different ways? And again, I'll let the girls talk a little more about some of the methods. But I think through the STEM project, we were able to come up with some really creative ideas, and I think real effective ideas on how we can manage these deer. And so not only is it a program to let the girls get outside, experience the outdoors, hopefully get enthusiasm about it so that they can serve and understand the natural resources, but it also is an opportunity for the Nature Center to gain insight. And so just a great partnership all around. So again, thanks.
So we bought quite a few materials with our grant money. We bought lots of cameras that are placed all over the Nature Center. And what the girls do is they go through thousands of photos. And they take a look and track how many deer, what kind of deer. And then our hope is that in the future we can look at fluctuations based on the data. And as new girls come in, they can look at new data and we can analyze that data and see what changes we see happening. So we bought cameras. Here's our first, the girls love this deer. They even named this deer. What's the deer's name? Yes, Fernando. It was our very first buck that we found. And so we're also keeping track of the bucks and where they are located on the property as well. So there's an example of one of our photos. We also bought a drone. And so again, this was much cheaper than doing the helicopter runs. And so we have a drone. Here's an example of a picture that we took. I don't know if you can see the deer right here. There's a couple of them in here. But what we're going to do is compare the data that we get from those aerial surveys to the data on the ground level that we are taking. The girls, this is their favorite part. And this is called deer survey at a transect point where they were counting deer pellets, if you know what a pellet is. That's what we'll call them, pellets. And so they're going to explain a little bit more what they're doing there, lined up in a row and walking around a stick. And so here's an example of what they were looking for. And some of our transects took us through parts of the property that were quite wet. Some of the girls liked it, some of the girls didn't. And this is an example of a girl who loved it. She wants to be a wolf biologist someday. Oh, cool. And so here she is standing along the transect collecting data. You can see the girls using a compass right there to get their direction to make sure they're following the transect. And really, this is research that college students would be doing, and these girls are experiencing that. So that's what we found was very exciting about this, is that they can handle it if we give them the opportunity. We find other things along the trail as well. You can I don't know if you can see this very well, but this is a jawbone from a deer, and so we had to look at that and age it, of course. Find out how old that deer was. Here's an example of some of the data that they collected. When we stopped and did data collection of pellets, we also looked at the amount of deer browse. So the students learned a lot about how to tell how much deer browse was happening in that area. And that's just basically what the deer eat. Are they eating, breaking off, you know, branches of small trees and stuff like that. So we were all over the property, I can tell you. And it was a beautiful day, and the girls absolutely loved it. What we're planning to do in the future, and this is actually coming up the end of October, and the girls are very excited, is that we want to build a deer exclosure. Here's an example of a deer exclosure. And it's an exclosure because the deer can't get in. And we want to look to see what's the vegetation like on the outside versus the inside. And so here's an example of one exclosure. Here's an example of another exclosure from Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. There are a lot of different designs. So our girls are going to participate in deciding and provide and producing some plans that they're going to present to the Nature Center as far as what they think that the deer enclosure should be made of within the certain budget constraints that we have. And And then they need to figure out, oh, how tall does it need to be? How large can we make it with our budget? And so we're going to have the girls working on that ahead of time before we head to the Nature Center and talk to the Nature Center about this and then actually go out and build it after we get the materials. And so that's coming up the end of October. Part of our funding for this trip this year, we received a grant from the Michigan Tree Farm Committee through Wheels to Woods, and I just thought this was so neat what they said about our group. The Michigan Tree Farm Committee reviewed your application and is pleased to award you the $200 for your transportation costs to the Chippewa Nature Center this fall and next spring. By the way, we have seen many excellent applications in our first 99 proposals, but your work with the 8th grade girls after school STEM club is exceptional. Thanks for doing great work getting young women excited about science and natural resources management. Your deer exposure project at Chippewa Nature Center will be a very interesting experiment to see the impacts of a high deer population on forest vegetation. This type of research is very important to forest and wildlife management across the state and nation. Hopefully, some of your students will be working for the DNR in a few years. So we thank them for that support. Also, Midland Public Schools is offering some money for the actual supplies, and so we're very thankful for that as well through the STEM budget. Now, I know that's kind of, you might be saying, well, a lot of girls, you know, according to this research, a lot of girls are into the biological sciences. And look how it drops off till you've got mechanical engineers over here, and females make a very small portion of that. So we want to branch out and do some other activities for the girls this year and allow them to choose which activities they want to be involved in. So one thing that we're very excited about is the Glowforge printer. This is a new printer. It's not quite out yet. Hopefully we'll have it by March. But the girls really caught the vision for having this printer. It's similar to a 3D printer. And so we were talking about how we could raise money for buying it or maybe getting another grant to get it. Well, our Northeast Booster Club, they saw what we were doing and they said, hey, we want to buy this for you. So we were so thankful for that. We're still waiting for it to come, but what the girls want to do for their first project is a fundraiser, and instead of selling cookies, let's make some of these devices. Do you know what those are? Virtual reality goggles. You stick your phone in there, and some virtual reality goggles are very expensive, but these ones you can just slap your phone in there and put it on, and it's like you're there, right there. And so we want the girls to just make this design better, because it's not perfect. So we'll do some different models and we can make these within the Glowforge printer. And so they can try different designs and then see which one seems to fit the head right and works best with phones, and then they want to sell them to the kids as a fundraiser for the group. So that's, we're hoping that these get into production quicker than March, but we'll see what happens. The girls are also going to be going to Delta College's Computer Science Girls Day Out. That's coming also at the end of October, where they can do several activities related to computer sciences. And we also have some other partnerships in the pot to hopefully get to. Alden B. Dow has contacted us. They heard about our group. And they would like to possibly do an architecture type of program with the girls. And we have a contact with Dow Chemical Company with a female engineer there, and she's going to actually meet with us tomorrow morning and talk about all of the activities and things they have for girls in STEM. We've applied for the SVSU STEM bus to come to our girls group. And then lastly, I'm going tomorrow for some training at the CMU Center for Excellence in STEM, where I'm going to get trained on the classroom set of drones and bring those drones back so that our girls can learn how to program those drones. So they'll not only, you know, the other drone was a little too expensive for us to have them playing with it. So, but with these, they can actually work on playing with those drones and seeing how they work. So this is our group that went with us. We haven't lost many from this group. They've really stuck with us. And so we have 6 girls here today. Would you come on up, girls?
I'll have them introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Jocelyn Johnson.
I'm Ella Jaster.
I'm Carly Williams.
Marissa Burgess.
I'm McKenna Town.
And I'm Ella Cloud Schneider.
So would one of you girls like to explain kind of what we did with the transect data?
So what we did is we
about a certain section, and we took a compass, and we lined it straight up with our stick, and we took a straight line. We had one person walk completely straight, and then we had about six or seven girls walk along the line as we walked around in a big circle. And as we're walking in the circle, we're counting all the pellets on the ground, as much as, well, piles. And along with doing that, we were also looking for the brows on the ground, and we did about 10 transects throughout the whole thing. We had, what, six or seven groups go about, so we ended up doing like 70 transects.
Wow.
Out of all the girls.
Whoa.
Any questions you have for the girls?
Did any of your data tell you anything yet?
Well, not quite yet, but we're hoping to get the formulas that we need to determine the amount of deer in the Chippewa Nature Center.
Okay.
What kind of formulas are you using? What will you be using?
Tom, do you want to address that one?
Well, first we took the drone survey, and that's actually a fairly actual count of how many deer are on the property. We did it when we had about a foot of snow, and you could see the pictures. You can actually count the deer. And we figured we had 50 to 60 deer per square mile based on the drone survey. And then with the pellet survey, there's actually equations from Mississippi State University that we're going to be using to figure out deer population based on pellet counts. And the browse survey won't tell us number of deer, but it'll show in relation what kind of browse we have. And then with the camera survey, we can't tell how many deer are on the property, but what we were able to tell is how many bucks are on the property, because you can kind of tell the different bucks. You know, some have 2 points, some have 4 points. One has 4 points that are like this, and the other one has 4 points that are out this way. And so you can kind of start distinguishing, and that's how they get the names of the different bucks. And so once we know the name of the, or the number of bucks, then we can figure out how many does, or what the buck to doe ratio is, and figure out what the population is. And so when they're doing the camera surveys, there's also an equation to show what the buck to doe ratio is. So those are some of the.
So you'd be applying mathematical equations to determine deer populations. That's a pretty cool use for math.
So I have more of a, just a general question. 32 clubs in the school, what was the draw to the Girls STEM Club? 8 months ago, you had been, when that was created, what made you want to join?
We were actually picked out. Mrs. Lennon looked at our previous math and science test scores, and she selected the girls that she felt would be fit for the group. So she came to us and asked if we'd be interested, and most of us actually did say yes. So that's where we all came.
That's fantastic.
How many are there total in the group?
Probably about 35 right now.
It's like a big group. How big of a group can you grow to?
Yeah, we're gonna have these girls be involved in the process, and the process might change for next year as far as how we allow students to be involved. Because I needed to start that way, you know, with choosing just to get it going. And but we'd like to open it up more. So we're not sure yet how we're gonna. The girls and I are gonna talk about maybe an interview process, because we want people that are gonna be interested and gonna stick with it. We just don't want people coming for a couple times and then saying, okay, I'm done. So the girls are gonna help us with that, figuring out a way to do that next year. And so then what will happen is they will kind of mentor the next group of seventh graders at the end of the seventh grade year, and then they'll then be the eighth grade group the following year. Is kind of the plan right now.
I imagine once you start designing and selling virtual reality goggles, everyone's going to want to be on board.
Then they'll move on to high school, and it might be how they ask their prom date out, right? What are you most excited about for this program, any one of you?
Well, for me, I'd say getting outside and actually getting to physically do stuff hands-on is a great experience. Getting to go out to the Chippewa Nature Center, maybe getting the STEM bus. Getting the 3D printer is another hands-on fundraiser that we can all work together to do.
Would anybody else like to comment on that question?
Well, for me, it's definitely thinking of new ways to improve the program, because I love being creative and coming up with different ideas. And I also really like doing the Chippewa Nature Center trip. It was a really good experience, and we had a lot of fun.
So are you making plans for ninth grade? Do you have thoughts of a group? group or anything that might be coming, or is this just right now in eighth grade?
This is all I can focus on.
No,
it hasn't gone beyond this. Possibly, maybe expanding to seventh and eighth grade together, possibly, but again, I need to get into it and develop some things first.
Right. No, it's fabulous, amazing.
In 8 months, it's an incredible development.
For all the young ladies, how many of you thought that science meant exact answers before you started all this? That there's just an answer.
Hey,
the formula, you get an answer. How many of you still believe that?
A little bit.
Good. You've already learned something very fundamental. I'm very glad to hear that. That's excellent. And I'm telling you, there are career opportunities for you out there in spades, no matter what area of science, engineering, and math you get interested in. It's there in infinite, almost infinite amount. So you can't go wrong. If you're interested, don't give up.
Do we have any other comments?
I just say, what Jerry's saying, it'll never feel like work if that's what you want to do with your career and your life, and that's what you enjoy. Stick with it, and you'll like going to work every day, which is, there's something to be said about that.
Oh, it's hard, but anything worthwhile is hard.
Thank you so much for coming out and sharing this with us, and good luck the rest of the year.
I want to buy a pair of those goggles when they're ready. Okay, good.
Thank you.
Let's do our meeting in VR.
Yeah.
All right, we'll pause while the...
We'll take a little pause while a few extra... Thank you so much.
Thanks for coming, everybody.
All of you.
We got finance coming up if anyone wants to stick around. No?
It's numbers.
Let's see if I can sneak out with them.
It's the numbers you run away from.
Oh, it's just going to be Roger and us. It's okay.
Thank you for that.
Don't hear that very often.
Right. We're getting heckled.
Thank you.
Hi.
Thank you. Thanks, Jeff.
There you go.
Here we are. Is there anyone left that would like to address the board? Are there any requests to address the board? Seeing none, we will move into curriculum, instruction, and assessment. And we have a meeting minutes from September, and I will go ahead and read those. On Monday, September 9th, our Curriculum Instruction Assessment Committee met Lynn Baker, Pam Singer, Jerry Wasserman, Mike Sherrow, and Brian Brutin, with guest presenters Luann Bensinger, Penny Miller-Nelson, and Scott Cochran. We talked about district initiatives, supports for new staff, STEM strategic plan instruction, Illuminate DNA data systems, and continued work on teacher and administrator evaluation reform. We also visited elementary level PYP authorization, phase two schools, and continued support for phase one schools. We talked about the secondary level schools, numerous curriculum efforts, including the establishment of essential standards and proficiency scales, supporting the Midland High School Math Initiative, and piloting the Carbon Time and MyStar curriculum projects. And finally, we talked about auxiliary subjects, participation in the countywide CTE collaborative. We had brainstorming topic ideas for future meetings, and then we were adjourned. So it was a very good meeting. Moving into item 6.2 for information. Bob, do you have?
You have the minutes first, I think.
Yep, I got the FFO minutes.
Sorry.
FFO met on October 11th. Angela, Patrick, and I were in attendance along with Mike and Mr. Cooper. Also present were the Barton Mallow folks and French Associate folks. We had a bond update on Central Park Elementary. The committee took an extended tour. The rest of the community is curious what's behind the fence. We got to see the Central Elementary construction site. Much progress has been made since the committee's last visit to the site, and construction remains on schedule And I'll add to the minutes, schedule means available for startup next school year. Mr. Dombrow also shared with the group an updated timeline of the various projects, bid deadlines, and bid awards over the next several months, and our next sequencing of projects. And early designs of the elementary upgrades were shared with us. Mr. Jerome shared the early design work at Plymouth Elementary and Woodcrest Elementary regarding the secured entrance, the gym addition, cafeteria addition, and the media center makerspace renovations. And we discussed July and August financials and liability insurance. The district general liability insurance was placed out for bid, and the timeline for the process was discussed, and our next meeting will be November 14th.
Very good. It sounds like a great meeting.
It was a good meeting.
All right, Bob, now we're over to you.
Right. I have for you actually, let's see, 1, 2, 3 pieces for information and 1 for action. You know, it's like everything else, the giving season ramps up, and if you notice summer, we still had stuff coming in, but it starts to pick up, and there's a couple here I want to draw your attention to. If I could start with 6.2, you'll see a couple items tonight, both 6.2 and 6.5 are gifts from our employees, which you don't see in all those groups always. The first one is a monetary gift to our 3 Title I schools of $431. And that's from the members of our paraprofessional local group here. They gave the money towards the title buildings. They wanted to spread it out to all of them. They originally were going to do that through a program, but it didn't allow for the money to go to Plymouth because Plymouth's not a school-wide. So they decided to give the money directly to us. And I know I saw answers from all 3 of those schools. They very much appreciated the efforts of the paraprofessionals that not just work there, but work across the district and giving that money to them. So I know they reached very happy and had thoughts of exactly where the money should go right away. So that was out there. So I'm gonna skip down to 6.5. I know it's a little out of order, but had another employee too, a retiree, Beth DeWise, who was an occupational therapist for us. And you can read there, and I won't read it through all the way, but a lot of the materials that she'd picked up through the years in her profession and used with our students. She donated those back to Midland Public Schools for our colleagues to use. And you can see there's a donated value of about $2,300 on the materials that she gave back. So again, there's somebody as they leave Midland Public giving something back. So 2 things, a little unusual, but very nice to get. If I can take you to 6.3 again for information, it's about $30,000 total. You'll see a lot of items there. I can kind of break it up into a couple different groups here. There's about $13,000 there from individuals at the start. You'll notice library books, memory of Cindy Casey. You'll see $1,000 to the debate team from Mr. and Mrs. Allen Ott, and it was matched by the Gerstecker Foundation. You'll see the Jefferson Parent Group with $1,350. You'll see just a little under $9,000 from the Woodcrest PTO. For things for their teachers, their wish list, as they call it, and $100 from the Ungerleiters for some books to go with the English program at Jefferson. And then one you hear me talk about often, the Community Gives, which is through Dow Chemical, but through the Midland Area Community Foundation. I think it's about $6,000 there. Everything you can think of, we often think of it as only going to sports teams, but you'll see the equestrians down there and robotics. So it's a nice program where they do a charitable activity, and if they're willing to give time to the community and a charity, then through the foundation, Dow Chemical rewards them back with $1,000 for their club program, whatever it happens to be. And then the Dow High Boosters Club, there's about $11,000 there for various uniforms, supplies, end zone cameras. You can see a little bit of everything there. If you put that with 6.4, which we'll talk about here just in a second, there's about $25,000 or so from the Dow High Sports Club, all sports boosters, excuse me, that they're donating this time around. 6.4 is where I do need to get you to. Because of the amount of money, as you know, get over $10,000, it does require your approval. This was a gift totaling $14,000, a little bit over $14,000, and it was for football uniforms, and they've purchased those, and again, they just need your approval to accept that gift.
I will move that we approve 6.4 and accept the gift totaling $14,310 graciously.
Gladly support.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? What a gift. That is very generous. Are there any other comments right now on any of the gifts?
Oh, I'll hold till after.
Very good. And we will move on to human resources.
We have no minutes for you this month. We will next month. We have three former staff members who have passed away we'd like to recognize and express our sympathy to the families. Mr. Lewis Filchek, who passed away on October 9th. Mr. Filchek was a bus driver in the transportation department for 17 years, retiring in 1999. And Mr. Donald Riesig, who passed away on October 11th. Mr. Riesig was an electrician and a carpenter with the maintenance department for 33 years, retiring in 1994. And Mr. Dio Freeman, who passed away on October 13th. Mr. Freeman did payroll and accounts payable in the business office for 33 years, retiring in 1998. Some longevity of service there. We also have an item 7.2, three staff members who have renounced a retirement, even though in the future, Joe Macheski, our benefits specialist, will be retiring in May of 2017, and Judith Schufal, hopefully I said that right, Judith, paraprofessional Northeast, December 21st of 2016, and Deborah Schaefer, paraprofessional at Plymouth Elementary on October 28th.
Good. It's nice to have that heads up for the May 23rd of next year.
Yeah, especially with Joe's position.
Okay, now we move into correspondence to and from the board. You can see items 8.1, information letters going from the Board of Education to Jefferson Parent Advisory Committee, Chestnut Hill Elementary PTO, Plymouth Elementary PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Kevin Scroggin. 8.2, we had a FOIA request regarding purchasing records from Smart Procure. Item 9, we have scheduled activities for your information, and which moves us right into our study discussion. So if we could end out with any comments for study discussion, I'll start with Patrick.
All right, congrats to both Shining Stars tonight. Always fun to see, nice to see people who've worked their way up and to the roles they're in, and appreciate that. Really enjoyed both presentations tonight, especially the Carpenter group. Nice seeing young kids taking ownership of their school, deciding what they do and don't want for behavior, taking ownership of it and being the people that help fix the problems. It's nice to see. Obviously our programs are working in terms of identifying issues, problem solving, and and such. The gifts, nothing in particular, just every month to see the litany of money that comes in. It's always impressive. And then I think Friday night is the annual Midland High-Delhi football game. Good luck to both teams. Hopefully it's decent weather, and it's always a fun night. Good way to end the season, end the year. Good community event. And that is it.
Thank you.
Scott. I thought tonight was a great night. All of our donors are just simply astounding. And equally astounding, I think, were the two groups that presented tonight. And for anybody who says, well, why are you running again to be on the school board, I couldn't think of two better examples than the groups we saw tonight. And I will just simply leave it at that.
I'm going to do a special call out to our paras and Ms. DeWeiss, employees who are financially giving back to the district. And you know, our paras aren't the highest paid employees we have. And the fact that they extended that generosity is more than noted. And I'd like to thank them for their concern for our kids, both in what they do for their jobs and in this action. It was a big weekend for Dow High Sports. Congratulations to the boys tennis and the girls golf. It was, it's unreal. And as the paper said, how many championships in one day does a single high school get to experience? And hats off to everybody out at Dow High. And frankly, to those folks that organize Booster Bash. I mean, we think about tangential effects, the ability to have some of these programs, the ability to sustain these programs, there's a lot coming from that. So that success comes from all sorts of avenues, and that being one. Tonight's presentations were wonderful, but what didn't escape me, that caught me, was the leadership of our teachers and teaching coaches. We saw that in spades tonight. And, you know, kids learn in a variety of different ways. And one, maybe the strongest way, is by example. And I think these students, as they see these adults in their life exhibit leadership traits like that, will absorb that and emulate that in the future. So it speaks very well for future leaders. And thank you to those grown-ups that were here tonight that show that example to our kids, because it's not just the instruction, it's the example. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have to agree with Scott. These are the reasons we want to run again. I just wouldn't want to miss these presentations. Just when you think you've seen the best of the best, another one comes along that just knocks your socks right off again. They were just too much. And I agree with Jerry, too. We have excellent teachers, and they do such a great job. And our kids are so lucky, and we're so lucky to have them. I just really enjoyed the presentations tonight. Also, I thought it was really nice to see the shining stars and the support mm-hmm. they got from their coworkers. That was really nice. They must be a great group to work with.
Thank you. I was blown away by the generosity of our pairs as well. That was very heartwarming to see. The presentations tonight hit me, because when I start thinking about project-based learning and what we're doing with STEM and how the brain retains information, I was looking at some research, and it says if you set and get, if you are in a lecture, you will retain 5% of what you learn. If you reflect, you will retain 50% of what you learn. If you teach someone else, you will retain 90% of what you learn. And by what we heard tonight, that is exactly what's happening, and that is why I'm so excited about STEM education, what we're doing with project-based learning, with PYP, with these STEM clubs, and now with the new elementary. I think we're moving in a great direction, and I'm excited for our future. And that's all I have. Mike, do you?
Yep. Last week we were notified by the Michigan Department of Ed that we received an $83,000 grant for early reading interventions, and Luann Benzinger was the applicant for that, so give Luann a shout-out on that. And that will help us get ready for the third grade straight reading initiative that's coming at us. So our present kindergartners will fall under that initiative, and so we can put some interventions and begin to study on how we're going to get all kids to that benchmark here in the near future. So great job by them. Also, I think I neglect to tell you, a month or so ago, Bridget and Shannon were able to secure an outdoor learning space grant for that over at Central Park Elementary, and $10,000 from the Dow Chemical Foundation. So thank you very much. That'd be the second time Dow Chemical Foundation has assisted us at Central Park. School safety, I wanted to address that tonight, and where we are and where we've been heading. And so I think we spoke before that Tom Meinsberg, a school safety expert, has been working with our staff. Last spring is probably when we talked about it. He trained all of our teachers last spring in a session on safety planning in reaction to an incident. Tom will be back again next month in November to train our support staff as well. So they'll be receiving their training. And through the summer, Tom provided a template for us to update any of our safety plans. And so we had safety plans in place, but now that we have them in place and they're somewhat uniform, and the Midland Police Department has worked closely with Tom as well, so we have all that on board. I think Jerry mentioned in the minute notes for the FFO that the design for the secure entries is begun. The first two at Woodcrest and Plymouth are designed, and the following buildings will be done soon to go out to bid, and those projects will start on April 1 of this year, and the schedule to be completed at the start of next school year. And so secure entries are in place. But along with those secure entries, you know, if you recall, part of the bond plan was also camera monitoring, ability to lock doors down, those type of pieces as well. So we have several of those pieces coming as well. So the plan that we laid in place with the bond is beginning to take place in addressing school security. And when I talk about school security, I also want to talk a little bit about our work that we've been working with some community partners on mental health initiatives. You know, in my mind, the violence that occurred in our society isn't so much about the weapon that's used, it's so much about mental health. And so many of the school incidents that have occurred in our country since Columbine so many years ago has been mental health and has been inside. So it's not necessarily outside attackers into a school. And so it's mental health issues. And so this work to help identify early, to keep kids healthy, to help kids deal with stress, depression, those natural things that we all go through at some point in life, should help assist us as well by keeping our kids safe as we go forward. So lots going on in that area as we work through there as well. Central Park parking lot, if you recall, I think it was 1977, the district had ceded the parking to the north of Central Park to the city for the old Civic Arena. Before my time, you guys probably, some of you will remember that. And so we now need that back for our park. John Lynch has worked with the city and has finished that completion, and we've got a signed agreement in place where it's back into our hands with the agreement still that the city will use it for their Central Park needs on the weekends and evenings as well. And so great work with the city. John's always so good to work with as we go forward, so thank you to make that happen. Student count day was about 10 days ago. I gave you a little bit of data there. If you recall, last year's blended counts, we have to blend them, was 7739. As of count day 2 weeks ago, we would have said 7721. That looks down, but technically, if you add in our partial FTEs from the parochial schools and some of the other services that we provide outside, usually that's around 30. It looks like that will be slightly up or balanced, which is what been our estimate all along has been. And so that's good, particularly when you look at what we budgeted at. So, you know, we had to budget, and many people forget that's a shot in the dark. Last June, it's your best guess estimate based on what's going to occur, and certainly a very volatile environment out there for us with employers and those type of things going on. So you generally estimate pretty conservatively, which we did at 7685. And so yet to be certified. We won't actually get that certified usually until almost December, Bob. And so it'll be a while before we actually get that certified, but right now it's looking to be a plus to us financially. Our student count is plus. We want as many students as we can educate. As you can see by the great things that are going on out there today, 32 clubs to grow students' interest. I mean, we need to get as many kids here in Midland Public as we can because they're going to learn a lot from us. A little bit on our STEM strategic plan. If you recall, a big piece of that plan was to provide our teachers with extra certified assistance in those STEM areas when they begin to teach. And so we've been partnering with Saginaw Valley, Michigan State, and talking with them. We've had a little more success on the Saginaw Valley side as far as pre-intern or student teachers, their interest in placing them to assist us. In fact, they're a year ahead. They approached Brian at the beginning of the school year, and they are placing 16 pre-service science methods teachers at East Lawn this year. So we get to try that out, see how that works, and when we get into Central Park, that's gonna be a plus. As we know, those putting 25 to 50 kids in those maker spaces will require more than a couple set of adults' eyes and hands in there. So we're trying to figure that out as we go through, very much so. If you recall, when we negotiated our last contract with our Teachers Association, we switched insurances. They went to a HSA. One of the things we had to deal with was the runoff cost for our self-funded plan. The teachers had agreed to try to cover that cost with their HSA not being fully funded. And so we're in year one of that, and we're getting very close to, by January 1, end of December, we'll have the actual runoff cost. And so a quick estimate of that right now shows that about $470,000 was secured this year with their HSA savings, but our runoff costs are approaching close to $900,000, about $870,000 right now, could get to $900,000 by the time it ends. And so going into year two, the amount we fund their HSA is based on how much would be still owed in year two. We are estimating about $400,000 still needs to be covered, and that their HSAs will probably be the contribution we contribute to the HSA is slightly increased to probably around 400, 800 or somewhere in that area. So a slight increase, probably not exactly what they were wishing for, but there will be an increase in there, and then probably will be covered after year two. Remember, we had some doubts if it would be covered completely in year two, but it will be. So that's probably good news that they're done with that as well. And that's all I have for you tonight.
Okay. Okay, it's 8:09 and we will adjourn this meeting.